for us on this day. Just a little bit of a heads up that we're going to be doing a lot of singing tonight, and we're not going to have you stand during the whole service. I will have you stand and be seated at different times. We're going to start off the service seated. We're going to be going through some Bible reading tonight out of Isaiah 53. This was written roughly 700 years or so before the crucifixion, but it goes into great detail and specificity about what Jesus would do and what it would mean for us. So we're going to be going through that tonight. And actually, that passage starts at the very end of chapter 52, so that's where I'll start it off. It says this: "Behold, my servant shall act wisely. He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. As many were astonished at you, his appearance was so marred beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of the children of mankind, so shall he sprinkle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him, for that which has not been told them they see, and that which they have not heard they understand. Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not."
Jesus, Beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss! The father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Why should I gain?
Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom.
Isaiah 53, verses 4 through 6. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was a chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all.
Let's go ahead and stand.
with a sorrow to trade the debt we owe. Your suffering for our freedom. The Lamb of God in my place. Your blood poured out. Sin erased, it was my death, you died. I am raised to life, hallelujah, the Lamb of God. My name upon your heart, my shame.
Where your love ran red and my sin white. I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you. Surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus.
Go ahead and be seated. We're going to take part in the Lord's Supper as we remember, as it says in the Word, remember what Jesus has done for us. And this is for everyone here who is a believer in Jesus Christ. If that is you, then that is the only biblical requirement for taking part in this, that you have placed your trust in the finished work of Christ alone for your salvation. The mystery of the cross I cannot comprehend. The agonies of Calvary. You, the perfect Holy One, crushed your Son, who drank the bitter cup reserved for me. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table, Jesus, thank you. By your perfect sacrifice, I've been brought here.
washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. Lover of my soul, I want to live for you. Lover of my soul, I want to live for you. Lover of my soul, I want to live. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you. Your blood has washed away my sin. Jesus, thank you. The Father's wrath completely satisfied. Jesus, thank you. Once your enemy, now seated at your table. Jesus, thank you.
For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me."
Jesus. Christ died for me. How sweet the sound of saving grace. How sweet the sound of saving grace. Christ died for me. Merits of your great high priest have bought your liberty. Relying on his precious blood, don't fear your banishment from God, since Jesus sets you free. Jesus, all my trust is in your blood. Jesus, you've rescued us through your great love. How sweet the sound of saving grace. How sweet the sound of saving grace. Christ died for me. How sweet the sound of saving grace. How sweet the sound of saving grace. Christ died for me. All my trust is in your blood. Jesus, you've rescued us through your great love.
In the same way also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Isaiah 53 continues on. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to a slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. And as for his generation, who considered that he was struck off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people? And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul, he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide with him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and makes intercession for the transgressors. Let's stand.
All-sufficient merit, shining like the sun. A fortune I inherit by no work I have done. My righteousness I forfeit at my Savior's cross. Where all sufficient merit did what I could not. In love he condescended, eternal now in time. A life without a blemish, the Maker made to die. The law could never save us, our lawlessness had won. Until the pure and spotless Lamb had finally come. It is done, it is finished, no more debt I owe. Paid in full, all sufficient, merit now my own. I lay down my garments, any empty boast. Good works now all corrupted by the sinful host. I'm dressed in my Lord Jesus, a crimson robe made white. No more fear of judgment, his righteousness is mine. It is done, it is finished, no more debt I owe. Paid in full, all sufficient, merit now my own. It is done, it is done, it is finished, no more debt I owe. Paid in full, all sufficient, merit now my own. Sufficient merit, firm in life and death. The joy of my salvation shall be my final breath. When I stand accepted before the throne of God, I'll gaze upon my Jesus and thank him for the cross. Yes, I'll thank him for the cross. It is done, it is finished, no more debt I owe. Paid in full, all sufficient, merit now my own. It is done, it is done, it is finished, no more debt I owe. Paid in full, all sufficient, merit now my own. Oh, your merit now my own. Oh, your merit now my own.
Throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. The great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. A name is graven on his hands, my name is written on his heart. Tongue can bid me thence depart.
often tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within. Upward I look and see him there who made an end of all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me.
Because a sinless Savior died.
Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood. My life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God. With Christ my Savior and my God.
Thank you. mercy is all my joy. Forever I lift my heart and my voice. Sing of a treasure no power can destroy. Jesus, your mercy is all my joy.
Praise the King who bore my sin, took my place when I stood condemned. Oh, how good you've always been to me. I will sing. Praise the King who bore my sin, took my place when I stood condemned. Oh, how good you've always been to me. I will sing of your mercy.
Ask you to remain standing for the reading of God's word. Paul the Apostle wrote these words to the churches of Galatia. He said in chapter 3, "For all who rely on the works of the law are under a curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not abide by all the things written in the book of the law and do them. Now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. But the law is not of faith. Rather, the one who does them shall live by them. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree, so that in Christ Jesus the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith." Father, we are so grateful, and we are so humbled to be here tonight to remember the death of your Son, that death that you decreed from all eternity for your glory and for the benefit of everyone who would ever believe. Now, as we draw near to the end of our time together, as we spend a few minutes looking at your word, I pray that you would continue to remind us of the unbelievable gospel of your Son, that it would cause us to leave here rejoicing, filled with awe, filled with worship, that we would treasure the Lord Jesus Christ for the remainder of our days. And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated. In Galatians chapter 3, Paul, in this section, he really sets up two ways to live. There are really only two options in this passage. The first option is you can live by the law. That is to say, you can work with all your heart to earn God's favor by obeying the demands of the law. Maybe some of you have tried that. The consequence of such an approach is found in verse 10. Paul says it very plainly. If you live by the law, you are under a curse. The Greek word means this: you are doomed to judgment. In verse 11, Paul says that no one then is justified by the law. And here is what I have discovered, and I'm sure if you have tried over the course of your life to merit favor in the eyes of God, or to live according to the law, or to be a good Baptist and be a law keeper, have you ever tried that? That the more you try to live by the law, the more it keeps beating you down. That's just the reality of it. And so the first option in this passage, you can live by the law, or the second option is you can live by faith. Paul says in verse 11, the righteous shall live by faith. So you can live by the law, which places you under a curse, or you can live by faith and find yourself standing innocent in the sight of God, forgiven of all your sins, past, present, and future, imputed with the very righteousness of Jesus Christ, and declared righteous by a God who is holy, holy, holy. I don't know about you, but the option is rather obvious. I hope you're choosing the latter. I hope you're choosing to live by faith. And so as we draw near to the end of our service this evening, I want to just to take a few minutes with you and to explore two things. First, the means of justification, and secondly, the blessing of justification. First, the means of justification. The means of justification is, simply put, the shed blood of Jesus Christ. If Jesus had never shed his blood, none of us would be justified by a holy God. Romans chapter 5, verse 9 says, "Therefore, since we have been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God." And so as Paul says in this short passage in Galatians chapter 3, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. It's fascinating to me, the word translated redeemed actually comes from a Greek word that can be translated as the marketplace. It was a word that would have been very familiar to the first century mind. And let me just put it like this: people who are enslaved by sin need to be purchased. They need to be redeemed. And so the price of their redemption is the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Put it this way, if we are trusting Christ, if we are believing all that Christ accomplished for us on Calvary's cross, we have been purchased, we have been redeemed out of the slave market of sin. And so Jesus died on that cross as a substitute by becoming a curse for us. He paid the penalty for all our sin on the cross. Theologians call this penal substitutionary atonement. Jesus was not only our substitute, he also perfectly fulfilled the law of God. All that the law of God required, he totally satisfied it, first and foremost for the glory of God, but then also we reap the benefits of Jesus' obedience for us. This is the means of justification. And then secondly, and finally, the blessing of justification. It's so exciting for me to say this, that justification, being declared righteous by a holy God, is for everyone. It's not just for the Jews. It's for everyone, Jews and Gentiles alike. It is for everyone who banks all their hope and future exclusively on Jesus Christ. Paul says, "So that in Christ Jesus the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith." You know, we live in a divided nation, do we not? We really live in a divided world, but there is no such thing as segregation in the family of God. Salvation is for all peoples. It is for everyone who believes. And so what does it mean when we say that there are blessings of justification? It means first that you are pronounced not guilty before the heavenly bar of God. You are now right with God. Your sins are forgiven. You are granted the gift of the Holy Spirit who indwells our hearts by faith. We are now the recipients of his comforting ministry. We are the recipients of the teaching ministry of the Holy Spirit. As he does something very special, he guides us into all truth. And then finally, we are granted the gift of eternal life. This is the blessing that was promised to Abraham. This is the blessing that was promised to everyone who believes the gospel. By the way, this is the shortest sermon you're ever going to hear from me. The choice this evening is very simple. You live by the law and find yourself placed under a curse, or you live by faith alone. Martin Luther, one of my heroes, says it like this: "The law says, do this. The gospel says, Christ has done it all. The law requires works of human achievement. The gospel requires faith in Christ's achievement. Do you know how many times I've read that quote by Luther? And every time I am struck and I am encouraged. I have been walking with Jesus for over 50 years now. And I still need to be reminded that the law says, this is what you need to do, buddy. But the gospel says Christ has done it all. On this Good Friday, Christ's gospel stands before each of us today and offers us the blessing of justification. Our responsibility, we must hear with faith, we must believe the gospel, we must bank everything exclusively on the Lord Jesus Christ. We must treasure the Lord Jesus Christ. Luther says, faith apprehends nothing else but that precious jewel, Christ Jesus. And I've found over the years that the biggest roadblock to this kind of faith is pride. It's pride. Sinners want some credit for their salvation. But here's what the gospel does. The gospel is the holy battering ram. The gospel smashes all of our human effort. The gospel smashes all of our pride. The gospel tells me I can't save myself. The gospel puts me in a position where I must rely upon, depend upon, trust, and treasure the Lord Jesus Christ. And as you well know, one of the great cries of the Protestant Reformation was sola fide, faith alone. And so this is the stark reality. If you have banked everything exclusively on the Lord Jesus Christ, you are justified by faith alone. Our only response to this great reality would simply be to cry out, thank you for saving me. Let's stand together and sing this final song together.
Thank you for saving me. What can I say? You are my everything. I will sing your praise. You shed your blood for me. What can I say? You took my sin and shame, a sinner called by name. Great is the Jesus, my only hope, the Savior of the world. Great is the Lord, we cry. God, let your kingdom come. Your word has led me see. Thank you for saving me. For we know your truth has set us free. You set your hope in me.
Thank you all for coming. We hope to see you on Sunday morning. Have a great evening. You're dismissed.
Your glory.